Okay, welcome everybody this evening. Thanks for coming out on a pretty miserable evening, but it will be a very stimulating talk, I'm sure, which you'll all enjoy. So first of all, I'd like to welcome you all to the last in what I'll call the regular series for this year's Our Changing World public lectures. And before I introduce tonight's speaker, I'd first of all really just like to thank all of you who've participated in the lecture series over the last few weeks. I'm sure you'll have agreed it's been a fantastic range of talks that's been there. And really, I'd also like to invite you to the finale next week, which is the Enlightenment lecture. So this time next Tuesday, the Enlightenment lecture that is given by an invited external speaker, and our external speaker is Julia Martin-Lefebvre, who's the former Director General of the International Union for Conservation of Nature. And the title of the Enlightenment lecture is The Promise of 2015, Hopes for a New Environmental Enlightenment. I hope you can all make it. It will be a fantastic event. Tonight will also be a fantastic event, and tonight's speaker is Professor Emilios Avgouleas. Emilios is the inaugural holder of the Chair of International Banking Law and Finance at the University of Edinburgh, and is Director of the Edinburgh LLM in International Banking, Law and Finance. He's also been appointed as visiting scholar to Yale and a visiting professor at Harvard Law School. Emilios is a global expert on financial market regulation, banking law, global economic governance, and the Eurozone crisis, and is a regular advisor to multiple governments and NGOs in these areas. As a little bit of a plug, in addition to his numerous publications, he has co-edited a book, which will be coming out, I think, next year, entitled Reconceptualizing Global Finance and Its Regulation. Tonight, the title he will discuss, From Speculative Finance to Sustainable Finance. Emilios.
Thanks. Thank you very much for being here tonight. The weather is miserable. Hopefully the experience will not. Many thanks to the organizers of the lecture series, especially Marian Datia, who is also the inspiration for this. What we are going to discuss today is, first, why markets have failed. Secondly, is there a way to fix them, to make them do good? Obviously, there is the suggestion that the markets always do harm, and there is no reason to have markets, especially financial markets. Well, this presentation stands right in the middle with proposals for the future. And of course, I know that the markets are a broken institution. My pathetic student studio at Patchell Road in Kentish Town, which I had because the rent was lower than the LSE halls of residence, was just sold for £500,000. Of course, there is something wrong. But the question is, can we put it right? And of course, in order to do that, we first need to identify what has gone wrong. Now, putting anything right in the markets means changing the institutions which underpin the markets, because however much we want to believe the neoliberal theory that the markets exist on their own, as a matter of fact, the markets are political, legal, and social institutions. Not very far from how Carl Polanyi was describing them, but for the fact that the government does not regulate the invisible hand. So as far as I'm concerned, financial markets are something that combines Adam Smith's vision of economic activity with Carl Polanyi's vision of how economic institutions come about and function. Now, this is what we know about the markets, are scary places. If market prices go up, the stock market prices go up, there are fireworks. And here are a few traders expecting the fireworks, which of course will translate into bonuses. And if they don't go well, this is the sign of skepticism and can get worse. You see, this is a sustained bear market, and the bear is upon the traders. And if the bear market lasts for very long, this is going to be the result. Job losses, falls in asset prices, diminished economic activity. Why? After all, what we know from neoclassical and not neoliberal economic theory is that financial markets are a fabulous institution that helps to mobilize the resources of society and use them, allocate them efficiently. And they do that by providing the infrastructure for mobilizing and pooling of society's savings. They provide the infrastructure for the processing of information, and because it's competitive processing of information, we rely on it. We believe that there is integrity in the way financial markets process information. And because if the market is information efficient, the market is full of necessary amounts of information, and we have lots of buyers and sellers, the result is competitive pricing. We can rely on the signal of value that market prices provide. And that's, as a matter of fact, a social function. If we rely on that and not on the hunch of a bureaucrat, resources are allocated more efficiently, in principle. And of course, they are a very good way to diversify risk, to manage risk, and as a matter of fact, to have more investments. The more our economic institutions give us the chance to diversify risk, the more investment which comes with risk we can undertake, in principle. Whether the markets can do good has been a time-old question. It's not a new one. And for those of you who have read anything about ancient Rome, one of their most important gods was Janus, Aianus. Aianus had two faces. On the first face was the face of peace, and on the other was the face of war. And this is exactly what's the case with financial markets. And when I say financial markets, I mean all the components of the financial system which systematically, recent and older, empirical research has shown to help because of encouraging efficient risk-taking, because of efficient resource allocation based on competitive pricing, and competitive pooling and monitoring of information to lead to efficient outcomes, and that means economic development. And as a matter of fact, if you look at the empirical research, developed economies have a developed financial system, and developed financial systems entail developed economies. There is a dual causation link there. Now, and this is very important, and this is very UK pertinent. And as far as I'm concerned, I take full responsibility for this assumption. I was telling my class today that the difference between the societies that caused what happened in Paris and so on, and the European medieval societies, was that finance eventually, there was no difference. European medieval societies were as dangerous, as bigoted, as prejudiced against anybody who was not them, as the societies that caused the extremely sad events in Paris. Societies that didn't have much value for human life. what happened is that the financial system provided the resources to the economy to create opportunity, especially, and this started in the UK, this started in Britain. This is the Industrial Revolution. The Industrial Revolution was nothing else but an intellectual breakthrough. The reason that it became economic revolution was that there were people there who stood ready to invest their money and undertake jointly the risk of the investment. Now, this had a profound political impact on British society. Proof that it did are these, well, that's in the next slide. But why finance has an impact on liberal democracy, and I hope the events in Paris made all of us appreciate what we have. And what we have is liberal democracy, with all its flaws and shortcomings. Why? Because we don't maintain waste in the system. If money flows around and goes to the efficient resources, the old economic class goes to redundancy. The new economic class arises, provided that this is not based on bankers' bonuses, but is an economic class that creates production and economic growth. It's not self-referring. It's not provided that financial activity is not divorced from economic activity, is not self-referential. And that has a political impact as well, because as a matter of fact, not only availability of finance, not only boosts economic and thus social opportunity in terms of economic and social mobility, but also has some impact on poverty eradication, and even more importantly, has impact on democratic enfranchisement. The fact that Europe's markets today are broken and radicalism is on the rise for many reasons, but one of them is there is no opportunity. In continental Europe, there is no opportunity. The contrast with 19th century UK is that there was tons of opportunity, not for everybody. This doesn't mean that the markets are a solution, are a replacement for social policies. But it was an opportunity for a class that didn't exist before, what we call today the middle class. Today's middle class has its origins to people who took advantage of the economic opportunity that the Industrial Revolution afforded to them. And that opportunity translated into political power. And political power translated into political reform, which in the UK had, in Britain, had the form of electoral reform. Only the landed classes had a vote. Everybody else was politically disenfranchised. Now, I have on purpose picked up these reform acts, excluding the 1884 and excluding female suffrage, because it's for sure that these social developments and the workers' movement and so on and the feminist movement that brought about electoral reform in 1884 with the universal franchise or the female suffrage. However, these electoral reforms, 1832 and 1867, which includes the emancipation of Catholic vote, of Catholics, were just the product of rising middle-class political power. These reforms spelled the death of the feudal oligarchy in the UK. And that's why I have not mixed them up with other electoral reforms. Now, they've done that in a period that the financial markets are functioning pretty well, but the banking system is a joke. First of all, the banks are not highly leveraged, so they don't lend much, and those who lend much end up in the rubbish bin, in the rubbish heap of history. The failure of the Overend Gurney, a very big bank in the 1860s, which was competing with the Bank of England, is what triggered Walter Budgett's Lombard Street. But you, as I said, this is an economic organization that has two faces. And has two faces regardless of misuse, because it entails inherent risks. What are these risks? It's prone to instability. And it's prone to instability because its users are prone to herding, are prone to panics. We'll discuss that a bit later. It's fragile. It's vulnerable to contagion. And it's fragile because it fundamentally relies on user confidence. The minute that confidence disappears, there is a stock market crash or there is a bank run. And finally, there is lots of debt, which is building up and building up and building up through the decades. Lots of debt compared to ownership, what we call leverage. And another characteristic is that financial institutions, financial intermediaries, are using other people's money. There are very serious agency costs. These, as you can see, are investors waiting to hear the news about their investment from their broker. And if they are academics who only expect their pension, income from their pension like me, it really feels like being on edge, doesn't it? So it's other people's money. And because of these fundamental characteristics and not just today's abuses, we had panics back then. The United States had a major bank run, a major bank collapse every 10 years in the 19th century. The stock market crash of the 1929 and what followed it, which of course was social and economic devastation. This family lives in a car. The American Chamber of Commerce says, jobless men keep going. We cannot even feed ours. Don't look for employment here. The American Chamber of Commerce. This guy is ready to sell his precious car for $100 because he has nothing left. So market catastrophes are anything but new. And they are anything but new because the minute that confidence disappears, the financial system will collapse. It's inevitable. However, what has changed, and has changed radically, is that while financial markets had embedded in their DNA a forthcoming crisis, because at some point crisis would disappear and investors would act irrationally, nobody until the 1970s or the 1980s disputed the fact that if they work properly, they are a force for good. They provide fresh capital, fresh finance to the economy, and they allow the economy to grow. This disjoint, this divorce between financial activity and economic activity is a product of the 80s and onwards. Those of you who have watched Wall Street and you remember Gekko, ancient history, I guess most of you in the audience are very young to have watched that, but I'm sure you have watched The Wolf of the Wall Street, where all you see, in a parody of course, is self-referential economic activity that has nothing to do with what's going out there. Okay, so the question is, how markets became like that? First of all, I think it's good for us conceptually to define what we mean by speculative finance, because not all speculative finance is a bad thing. After all, if we have lots of activity in the market, we have lots of liquidity, and liquidity is a good thing. Speculative finance is financial activity that is very short-term and leads to rapid conclusion of transactions. Money and assets change hands rapidly, well, these days in a fraction of a second with high-frequency trading. Obviously, it is self-referential, even though sometimes can be helpful to correct market anomalies. So-called arbitrageurs see a pricing inefficiency. They think the price should be the specific stock or bond should be priced better at that level, and they buy or sell, and they correct the pricing inefficiency. But normally, when you have so much activity, and you will see how many trillions I'm talking about, it's self-referential. And when I say self-referential, I mean gambling. It has no true social value. We use precious resources in order to gamble. That cannot be right. And definitely, it's wasteful from a welfare point of view. So this is the first thing that has gone wrong. We have too much speculative finance these days. Why? Because it was assumed that the markets cannot do wrong. Efficient and rational actors would always correct any market dysfunctions. The other reason is financialization. In the 70s, the house. Houses were places for people to live in. If you were economically minded, you would buy a house in order to hedge the risk that rents would go up. In the 2000s, my pathetic studio was sold for $500,000. Something has changed, because the rent on that is definitely no more than £500 per month. Something has changed radically. What has changed is that we have financial activity for the sake of financial activity, because it generates serious commission income for the financial intermediaries. And this is self-perpetuating, because the more economic power financial intermediaries have, the more political power they gain. This is what we call the Wall Street complex, or the Wall Street lobby. The more money they have, the more money they can expend on political contributions, and so on. I wonder where all these billions that presidential candidates collect in the United States to run their campaigns come from. I guess from the US pensioners. And systemic risk, which has always been part of the market function, but very rare, has become very common, and the systemic crisis has become a very common thing. Why? Because the markets today are much less transparent. They are very complex. Anybody but market professionals cannot understand the products, cannot understand what's going on. And of course, it has all come together. My mortgage becomes a bond that is then mixed up with another bond and gives rise to something that's called a collateralized debt obligation. And that CDO, which is a debt instrument, as a matter of fact, is insured against risk with another financial instrument that's called a credit default swap. Interconnectedness becomes stronger and stronger and stronger. And this is how rational investors behave. So, efficient and rational markets, this is how investors normally behave. It's called herding. They follow the herd leader. And let me show you what I mean by interconnectedness. This is how Wall Street has moved into the mortgage and the housing market, has created very exotic financial products that in the end brought everybody down. And the question is, how this has happened? What on earth happened there? And the answer is, commission income and profit for short-term sales and purchases became much more important. And also, if you control information, if you have superior access to information, inevitably you will make more money than those who do not, especially if it is a market setting and we compete who is going to make more money. The guy who has better access to information will make more money. Even worse, if I give you a product that I know will fail and I'll make money, and you stand no chance, but you don't understand the product because it's so complex, so mathematical, so difficult to price and identify the risk, you're always the loser. This is what has changed. The game has been shifted at the expense of the investment community and in favor of investment intermediaries. And then, as banks became bigger, as you know, Orwell says that all animals are equal, but some animals, in fact, he refers to pigs, are more equal. So here, all economic institutions are equal, and they can fail and then trigger insolvency law procedures, but some institutions are more equal, and they cannot be allowed to fail, and they cannot be allowed to go insolvent, which means they operate at the expense of the taxpayer. This is what we call too big to fail institutions. Now, all this, as we'll see in subsequent slides, apart from being very short-termist and all built on debt, if I am too big to fail, there is no reason for shareholders to build any equity there. Creditors will keep lending me money because I will never fail. I will never enter insolvency procedures. Creditors will never register losses. And there is no reason for me to, unless the regulator does that by inserting equity requirements on bank owners, you cannot operate the bank unless you have 20% equity, which is not the case today. That's self-perpetuating, because as shareholder, I'm only interested in returns. And the creditors will not stop lending. Returns means I expand my balance sheet. I lend more. I can do that on the basis of your loans. That's what we call leverage. And of course, the more money you make, the easier it is to capture the politicians, the easier it is to capture the regulators, and volatility. Now, look at the socially, in inverted commas, useful transaction. I mean, this is a simple transaction. And of course, the dots all show securities and money changing hands. The dots all show a series of financial contracts. The purpose of this is for a hedge fund to borrow money, to borrow the securities. First of all, sell securities that it doesn't have, and then borrow the securities and settle at a lower price and make money. This is the essence of short selling, which in some cases does have a socially valuable function because it amounts to rapid dissemination of information to the market via the prices. But look how many transactions it generates. Something that is rarely socially useful, and normally it is socially and economically disruptive, and its only purpose is speculation. Think how much commission income, and so on, all lawyers are employed. How much commission income is generated, or lawyers are employed there. Fundamentally, the only thing that you have that is real is a pension fund lending its securities. Now, of course, if property lending, that is intangible, property lending was not allowed, none of this would happen. So lawyers and parliaments, which produce legislation, and courts which apply them or generate them in Britain, have a share of the blame. The legal profession is not blameless in this, even though at the heart of this is a financial genius that tells you how many fractions of a pence you can do by doing that. And obviously, if you aggregate a million fractions of a pence, you've made 100,000. If you generate a billion, you just made your first million. And can be much more. And then we have something that's called the shadow banking. Now, the shadow banking is not inherently a bad thing, even though it means something that operates like a bank and it's not regulated. As a matter of fact, I could tell you that it could be a good thing from an economic viewpoint, because with any bank, regulated bank, you know that it will not be allowed to fail, so that propping up by the taxpayer is a social cost, and obviously that bank enjoys non-competitive lending from the central bank, the lender of last resort, whereas these guys do not. But this is half the story. The other half is that by collecting so much money, you do what? Do you invest them? No. What the shadow banking does is recycling the same money again and again and again, generating financial contracts which generate commission income. And if there are winners and losers in this game, it's pure gambling. Now, we don't talk about peanuts. Latest value, latest count is that has exceeded 70 trillion. Now, here is an important thing. You can take two viewpoints. The first viewpoint is the markets are evil. The shadow banking system operates in the shadows. All we want to do is have a fair world that is holy and so on. In order to build a fair and holy world, you need money. If you ignore 70 trillion available, probably you make a mistake. It's better to think cleverly rather than just give me lots of value judgments. If you want to bring Greece back from the brink, Greece needs investment. If you want to bring the sub-Saharan Africa out of poverty, you need money. And here is the fundamental question of tonight's lecture. Here is 70 trillion. Should I ignore them because it's shadow banking? Because the markets are evil? Because these guys are using the money to generate bonuses? Or I should make a rational and valid argument for a better use of that money rather than self-referential and self-fulfilling transactions? Now, this is how it looks. This is from a study of the US Federal Reserve. As a matter of fact, however much we magnify, all it generates is further complexity. We'll never understand how it works in full. However much we magnify this, somewhere here is the end investor, the savers, who push money to the money market funds, which operate as shadow banks. The money market funds buy paper that corporations issue And of course, the paper is mortgaged or lent and so on. It's totally self-perpetuating. It's totally self-referential, unless at the wholesale level, at the retail level, and at the retail level, shadow banking has nothing to do with this. It can serve to alleviate financial repression. In China, whatever you do, whatever is the performance of the economy, you will get 2% from the bank. The government will never allow the banks to give you more. So you can go to a shadow bank, an investment trust as they call it, which will give you 15%. But then the next question is, what the Chinese shadow banks do with the money? And the answer is they put it in real estate or the stock markets. And that's why you have gigantic asset bubbles, both in the stock markets and in the stock markets in China. So even when it serves a socially useful purpose, because at the retail level, it can alleviate financial repression, the end result is a bubble. And who is to blame for all that? Well, here is who's to blame. Here is a Wall Street banker. Everything has collapsed, mega deficits, toxic assets, executive bonuses, countrywide financial, AIG, Merrill Lynch, all these are venerable institutions that collapsed, General Motors, that collapsed during the crisis. And this guy tells him, that's a poor subprime mortgage borrower. This is all your fault. You bought a house that you couldn't really afford. So that was the moral of the recent crisis. But it cannot be thus. Having said that, we go nowhere if we don't identify the causes of the present market dysfunction. Why 70 trillion moving around, but Greece or sub-Saharan Africa doesn't get much, any? The answer is, anything that is long-term, has to be premised on a prediction of long-term value. And as the markets operate today, I cannot predict any value long-term because there is too much volatility. Prices, because of the rate of transactions, one every millisecond, it's impossible to rationally price anything any longer. And as a matter of fact, finance theories have contributed to volatility. The efficient market hypothesis tells you that you might, in the short term, predict prices, but nobody wins in the long term. That means that you cannot predict anything in the long term. And the behavioral finance tells you that you cannot predict anything in any case, short term or long term. But if I cannot predict anything, why should I invest? It's better if I speculate and take a gamble. Take a bet. And of course, with technology, having the ability to trade every millisecond, this problem is exacerbated. Don't forget that there are these trading houses that go and set up office. They set up store next to Wall Street One, which is the New York Stock Exchange, so that the telecommunications, the internet cable, gives them a time advantage over the other high-frequency traders who are based in Midtown Manhattan. And the cable is 5 miles away. So they even calculate the difference in the speed of connectivity of high-speed internet connections. What's the social usefulness of that? Now, there is another problem. Not only there is too much volatility, which is a very good incentive to gamble rather than invest, there is also lots of money around, lots of loose credit. The central bank interest rates determine, again in inverted commas, the cost of money. The lower the interest rates, the cheaper is for people to build leverage, to borrow money instead of investing their own. Now, that's a very serious problem, because that it multiplies the amount of money that of loose money out there that seeks to speculate, because what hope of predicting what's going to be my return on a long-term investment. And I think everybody knows that asset bubbles are at the heart of every financial problem we face today, including my Kentish Town studio. Now, this is what debt consumption does to you. This is Greece after the Olympic Games, which, of course, were debt-financed. So when debt is consumed, that includes the subprime borrowers, creates a certain level of euphoria. Stock markets go up. If you have a couple of shares in your pocket, you feel rich. House prices go up. If you have a Kentish Town studio, you're just half a millionaire. Huh? And this is what happens when the economic cycle or the leverage cycle goes down and money has to be repaid. Alexei, do not give Greece to the gangsters of the IMF and the ECB. What I call debt dysphoria. This is 2015, of course. Can we induce the markets to do good? Because on their own, it was an accepted convention in the past that they will do good, but you're also going to have the occasional crisis, and sometimes the occasional crisis would turn into a financial catastrophe, but overall, they could do good to today's assumption that not on balance, but most of the time, they do harm. Can we induce them? Not just control them, because they will find ways to escape the control net. That's why we have shadow banking, after all. To induce them to plan and invest long term. Planning and investing long term is these days nothing more than taking a long term economic risk in order to protect the environment and promote long term growth and the enhancement of social rights. Include women into the economic activity. Make child labor unprofitable, and so on. So, is there a way to make financial markets to take a clear commitment by investing in things that are environmentally sustainable, augment long-term economic growth, and promote socially beneficial goals? And this can include building a new Apple. We talk about capitalism here. I'm not talking about social economy here. I'm talking about capitalism. And building a new Apple is an extremely socially beneficial project, because my MacBook is environmentally friendly and the people who built it are probably well paid. But first of all, let's look at what's the problem in today's Europe, especially the countries that are ravaged by the crisis. The biggest employer in Southern Europe is small and medium enterprises. In Southern Europe, we don't like to answer to bosses. We like to be our own boss. But in order to grow as a small and medium enterprise, you need access to finance. You need access to new money. Impossible. Now, why Europe is landing is lagging behind the United States or Asian economies. The answer that this most venerable institution, the European Investment Bank, will give you is because there is not enough investment on research and technology or infrastructure in order to allow Europe to maintain its competitiveness. And here is the investment gap. Just to stay competitive where it is today, Europe needs 370 billion annual investment on research and development. The final output is 240. There is a nearly 50%, there is a nearly 40% gap there. Why? I just said that the shadow banking is turning around more than 67 trillion on an annual basis. Where is that money? Why is that money gambled in the global financial markets and is not invested here? Well, volatility. What's the rate of return here? Unless you incentivize them, because you cannot push them, the money will leave. You incentivize them to bring money into these areas, you will never see that private money. So what can we do? And by the way, we're in the 21st century. We cannot fight technology. We need to work with technology. We cannot just bedevil financial innovation. We need to use financial innovation in order to resolve some of the problems that our social security systems, for instance, face, and so on. And can we regulate everything, or there is a better and ancient way to organize and regulate investment activity and financial markets without telling its participants what to do at the very slightest detail, because complex markets generate complex regulation, and if anything goes wrong the next time, guess who is going to be blamed? The markets or the governments and the regulators? Is there a way outside the complex network of regulation to do something in order to induce the market to provide long-term investment? But first of all, what do we mean by financial innovation? Well, finance is nothing more than a series of innovations. The reason that we had sea trade in the Mediterranean was because wealthy Greek traders were willing to buy half of the cargo so that the ship owner would undertake the risk of the other half, so that wine or olives could be transported to Egypt and come back with grain. That's the ancient form of ship insurance. And of course, the ancient Mesopotamians had futures contracts. People could give a price for the harvest 6 months hence. And I've seen these ancient derivatives contracts. They are stones well organized, well appointed, within stone boxes. Okay, so financial innovation has been with us forever, and the most important one was the joint stock company, which financed the Industrial Revolution and stock markets. First of all, we need to think seriously as to whether, without banning them, without banning short-term or toxic investment products, we can disincentivize their use. And the best way is to decide what is a long-term and virtuous investment product. And I think it all hinges on how do we define a virtuous investment product. And I explained that should be something that entails a long-term commitment. Something that gives the investment a long-term perspective and also boosts growth, jobs, and respects the environment. If I have that idea, there are two ways to remunerate me. The good idea. You tax everybody else but me. You either allow me to patent my product, which will generate, like drugs, super competitive returns. That's how we incentivize the drugs industry to create drugs. Or, because that's too risky, and not all drugs are socially beneficial, I tax everybody else but you. But of course, you need a global convention for this. But there is a way. You have the good product, you do as much as you like with it. You have the harmful product, I'll tax that to death. But it's allowed. I'm not banning anything, I'm not prohibiting anything. And because not all harmful products are harmfully the same, and financial markets are not like human agents, are not like human bodies, we can't test drugs ex ante in order to allow them to enter circulation. But we cannot test financial products. They have to enter the market first. If you want this to work and not be regarded as an irrational loony, you have to accept that regular risk assessment exercises will be undertaken, and if the product proves to be good, exposed, the tax is lowered, and if the product proves to be toxic, exposed, you have to accept that, the tax will be hiked. Which means you create a continuous incentive for people to produce virtuous products and a continuous disincentive against the production of toxic, speculative, short-term investment products. If you have a global tax convention, it's the easiest thing to implement. It's not the same as the financial transaction tax, because the financial transactions tax is on transactions, whereas here it is much more flexible. You can tax the manufacturer or the trader. And of course, the manufacturer will charge the trader if you charge the manufacturer. It's not that the costs will not be rolled over. Same way as the market for consumer goods works. Same way as VAT works. And it's simple. The Dodd-Frank Act, which is a general principles piece of legislation, runs to 2,000 pages. Truth of the matter is I left the industry early, but between somebody who understands what's going on, this guy provides no value but helping the financial institution to comply. And the top paid professor, guess who earns more? So it's not complex at all. It's not utopian, and does something very valuable. It curbs volatility. Risks become uncorrelated. Less interconnectedness, less homogeneity, less of the markets move together. As the world turns, think of CNN. This is the morning bulletin of CNN, 5 a.m., for those who wake up at 5 a.m. The New York Stock Exchange has taken another dive. Paris is panicked. Not because of the recent sad events. London Stock Exchange has sunk. Frankfurt is falling. The DAX is falling. I remember that so vividly in 2008. Moscow is in the tank. Bombay is dead. Is going bad. There is havoc in Hong Kong. The Hang Seng, that is. Indonesia is worse. Tokyo's in tailspin, and so on. You will have much less of that because people will invest in less homogenized investment products, in less homogeneous investment activities. So not only you diversify better, but also you battle volatility. And as I said, I didn't talk about any altruistic vision. I talked about a capitalist vision where you still have cost-benefit analysis and people are still interested in making returns, in making profit. But this is what you're going to have. If you have another apple in Europe or 10 apples, you're going to have wages growth. And if you have 10 apples, the professors who teach informatics to people who will go and work for Apple will see their wages grow as well. And that's an issue of urgency because look, what's the share of the top 1% of the population, the share of the American income? That's the share of the wealth that American people have, not just the GDP. I'm sure they don't generate more than 5% of the GDP. As a matter of fact, I know that they don't because I've seen it in Forbes. So here is the 1% of the population that hardly generates more than 5% of the gross domestic product of the annual turnover of the American economy that owns, has wealth that is estimated close to 1/4 of the total wealth of the American people. And everybody talks about job destruction through technology. I have not seen any job destruction in Intel or Apple or Google or Facebook, whether we value their social usefulness or not. Or Twitter, even though where would I air my instant grudges about European economic policies if there was no Twitter? Probably I would take them on to students and would miss half the class with my ranting. So there is a socially useful function for Twitter. Now there are disadvantages. You cannot do that just by using a single government. But do you need a global government to do all that? No. You only need the most important countries to participate, the G20 countries. And of course we have what is called the trade and investment partnership between the United States and Europe, and you can insert things like that in these conventions, but you do need more than one country to participate. Otherwise, they will slip the net. Now, is it realistic as we come to the end of time? Is it realistic to force the markets to take a long-term view? This is the phase of investment in the world. That's Warren Buffett, one of the most famous people in the world. He only does long-term investment. His first investment was Coca-Cola, which made him seriously rich in the early 60s. Now, Warren Buffett is just one guy. How are you sure that you can really induce the market to behave like that? Let's look at a recent case study. How green bonds are debt instruments that are used to finance projects that mitigate climate change. How green bonds are priced. Am I talking theory here or market practice? Market reality, which has to be augmented and induced to produce the fruits of long-term growth. First of all, is the market willing? Demand outstrips supply. So the market is willing. Why the market demand outstrips supply? Voluntary coercion because pension fund trustees ask their asset managers to do that because their investors ask them to do that. And why investors ask them to do that? Since green bonds do not bring as much money as other bonds because they have a social environmental consciousness. Because our societal values and emotion matters. And the same way that can destroy the markets can fix and build markets. Now, let's see why it is sentiment. This is how much I make if I buy, in simple language, if I buy a common bond, one of those corporate bonds or government bonds that circulate in the market. And this is how much I'm going to make if I buy a green bond. Yet, supply, demand outstrips supply. Demand outstrips supply, even though this is how much less I'm going to make. And because here we talk about markets and the capitalist framework, long-term committed finance will allow clever people to thrive and offer all kinds of jobs. It's not a replacement for the welfare system, but it's a very good way to get our societies going. It will not resolve structural problems of poverty, but it will restart the growth engine of our societies. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So I'm skeptical about this idea of taxation. This year I've several times heard talk of even corporation tax vanishing in the near future in Europe. We've seen huge quantities of financial scandals here. The UK, as far as I understand it, has sent nobody to prison. And we're even seeing situations where the whistleblowers themselves are going to prison instead. So the capture that has gone on here, our legal system is letting the implementers of these evasions and escapes get off because it would harm their career. Literally, that is what some of the judges are saying. How do you, is this tax proposal not completely and utterly pie in the sky, seeing the way that our social structures currently operate?
Well, that's an interesting question. Obviously, this talks about a tax convention and letting people not sleep through the net. The problem with corporate taxation is that you have far too many loopholes. So no idea about a global tax will ever be successful if you have loopholes, hence the need for a convention. So that point is right, provided yet you have loopholes in the net. However, corporations at the same time have a defense. They provide jobs. On average, on balance, they do good. Most of these financial activity that I described is harmful. So I don't think that you're going to face the same opposition, because outside, of course, the financial service industry has money and has lobbies. But outside the financial service industry, I cannot see anybody opposing to finding a method to use all that loose money in a socially useful way. I can see why people will think, if my Starbucks profits are eaten up by tax, then there's nothing left for CalPERS, which is a pension fund and is a major shareholder. And if the money stays in Starbucks, the profit becomes dividend and is distributed to society in a different way. So in a way, the money that the UK's polity, the UK's taxpayers, lose from Starbucks is money that ends up in the pockets of CalPERS pensioners because they become corporate profit and thus dividends for the pension funds. There is nothing socially useful that these 70 trillion provide apart from bankers' bonuses. So the opposition to that is probably going to be politically much weaker. The room to implement that, the political will to implement that, will not be outstripped by the political will not to. Whereas taxation is a great thing, is an ethical thing, but Starbucks will always tell you whatever I save from UK's corporation tax ends up as dividends for my shareholders, and my shareholders are United States pension funds.
What do you think about the idea of a carbon market? Does
this... Of?
The carbon market.
Okay.
Does it further the problem by more financialization, or will it help to balance the problem?
As a matter of fact, I think the carbon market is a very bad idea. I think turning global public goods, like the environment and the protection of the of natural life, is a very bad idea. And I think the carbon markets are indeed a manifestation of what we call financialization, which is more or less a trend to to commoditize and then transactionalize everything, making it tradable. So no, I don't think that it's a good idea to have a market on clean air, in the same way that I don't think that it's a good idea to have a market on clean seas. If I pay for the benefit to pollute, then I should have the benefit to throw oil into the high seas and so on. Not only I think it doesn't make sense practically, I also think it's morally deplorable. Because then you have lots of clean seas. Why shouldn't I bring my environmental, why shouldn't I bring my toxic products and bury them into your seas so that they are less clean and you pay me a rent for that? You pay me compensation for that. How does that sound? Because the principle is exactly the same. So I don't think that the market has a place everywhere. What I say is that the market has a place in economic activity, and economic activity can be politically and socially beneficial.
Okay, let's have a question in the middle. The loopholes are put there by politicians. Most of the people on the committees who do it are accountants and lawyers. How are you going to incentivize politicians to stop taking the money?
I don't think I can answer that. That's an issue. That's a principal agent. That's a principal agent problem, and it's not just an issue for politicians. It's an issue as well for the principal to elect the right politicians. Here, we really put all the blame on the agent, not thinking that half of the UK's polity doesn't bother to go and vote. The fact that I have not voted in a Greek or British election since 2009, and I have dual citizenship. So I am to blame as much as any corrupt politician.
Thank you for your sharing. Nowadays, internet finance has emerged, especially crowded funding and peer-to-peer loading. Will this internet finance bring more risks to market? And what's the impact of that?
I think that's a fantastic question. And it has two limbs, two legs. The first is, has technology changed finance for the better? And the answer is, in the case of wholesale finance, Technology has changed the markets for the worse because of high frequency trading and rapid, it has induced transactionalization and it has induced complexity. At the retail financial services level, at the retail level of access to finance, it has done an awful lot of good because you don't need a bank in order to bank in deep Sahara. You can use your mobile phone. Or in the Indonesian jungle, you can use your mobile phone. And you don't need a bank account in order to buy goods because you can use Alibaba's Alipay. So I think at the retail level, it has done fantastic things. Now you mentioned crowdfunding. This is another manifestation of why good sentiment matters in the market. Most of the projects that are crowdfunded are good projects. And if you provide, these guys are managing what? Your money, my money, other people's money. And if you provide not just to the end providers and the supplier of finance is society, but to the people who manage our funds, who manage our money on our behalf with the right incentives, what you see with crowdfunding at the level of the end provider finance, you can start seeing at the level of the intermediary, the institution that intermediates finance between the end provider and the end user.
A lot of private equity firms deal in some of the things you're advocating, yet they also deal in collateralized debt obligations and loan obligations and also covenant-like loans. So how can you protect against the market digressing back to the state at which they're actually doing right now and doing a lot of the same things as a banking would do just in a private equity sense?
Chris, I explained it. You make it very expensive. And you make it very expensive by using the full panoply of a coalition of states. And you make it very expensive by taxing them. And by taxing them so that to make it very expensive and uneconomical means that they will not engage into that behavior. And since they will be prevented from engaging into that, you will not need to throw them in prison. You will not need to correct their ethics. You make it expensive, full stop. If they are rational players, they know that expensive is not touch. I need to move to something that's less expensive. And you just make that thing that's less expensive socially beneficial.
You used two phrases in your lecture. One, regulatory capture, which was the point that was raised about how do we get the politicians to change when they're being funded by the people who are the winners. The other expression you use is winners and losers. Losers would stop voting for politicians if they realized how much they were losing in this regulatory, in this financial churn of short-term, high-frequency, activity that makes so much bonus money for people in the economic industry.
In the financial industry. Has nothing to do with manufacturing.
Okay, in the financial industry. I can't see myself losing when these people are ripping us off. If people started to realize where the rip-off was coming, they'd start to look hard at their politicians.
I fully agree with that. Obviously, the capture of the political class is not the same as regulatory capture, because the political class produces the laws, the regulators implement and enforce them. So we have dual capture, and obviously the regulators either come from the industry or they need the captured politicians in order to further their careers. But the regulatory capture is really at the level of implementation and enforcement. I'm not sure whether there is a clear-cut solution there, because if you don't get a knowledgeable person, he might be an ineffective regulator. If you get a knowledgeable person, that's an ex-industry man or woman. Now, political capture is exactly as you said. If the principal, who are the citizens, knew that it is to their benefit to select the right politicians, otherwise, a rip-off comes on their way, things will have changed. And that's why what we discussed today is fundamentally a political issue. It's just that everybody talks about politics. So I didn't want to be yet another Greek who talks about politics. We are doing that for 2,500 years. I want to talk finance, where we are fundamentally weak. Having said that, indeed, fundamentally, in order to have anything like that, is a matter of politics and political representation.
Hi, I just wanted to return to one of the very first points you made, which is markets and finance as a precursor to liberal democratic societies. That struck me as a little bit of a catch-22, where a democratic society or a liberal society in some sense would be a precursor to a functional market. Could you talk a little bit more about that?
It is, and you're absolutely right. And that's why I mentioned that if you have a functional economy, you have a developed financial system, and if you have a functional financial system, you have a functionally developed economy. And these economies, of course, serve and underpinned by the serve a polity and are underpinned by the institutions of a polity. And if the financial system is not working properly, you have what you have in the impact on liberal democracy is as devastating as what we see in Southern Europe today. And by all means, Southern European countries are liberal democracies. And they, you might say they have become dysfunctional liberal democracies because of the rise of the extremes and this and that. But the question is, why now? Why Greece has a very strong neo-Nazi party now that is pushing 10% and never had that before after the end of the Civil War? The right-wingers and the left-wingers slaughtered each other to the vicinity of 700,000 lost lives in Greece up to 1949. Why Greece did not have a neo-Nazi party in 1950? Why Greece did not, even though it had a dictatorship, never had a neo-Nazi party until 2012? Is it irrelevant? There is no causation between the fact that the Greek economy collapsed, followed by the Greek state, the rise of the Greek neo-Nazi party? Isn't that what makes people in Europe growth, new jobs, have collapsed? So whom do the Europeans blame, including in Britain, for the collapse of new and good jobs? The foreigners. Hence the rise of the nationalist parties. Even though, if we open any economics textbook, we'll see that we have a new economic paradigm, and that's why jobs disappear. It has nothing to do with the foreigners. So if the economy starts showing signs of dysfunction, the liberal democracy will start showing signs of dysfunction. And the fundamental ideal of a liberal democracy is tolerance. What Voltaire said, I disagree with what you say, but I will defend up to my death with my own life your right to say it. If I don't have the right to say things, then I do not live any longer in a liberal democracy. Why things have turned in the UK? Has the UK polity become more patriotic in the 21st century of globalization and so on? It's the threat that globalization has brought through, and the fundamental threat is the threat that comes from speculative global financial markets. The fundamental threat is that there is somebody out there and is not a foreigner. Human beings have a brain. There is somebody out there who believes that my studio in Kentish Town can be sold in 6 months' time or a year's time for 600,000, and that's 10% return or 15% return. And it is that somebody that provides the money or provides the loan to whomever has bought it for $500,000. What does that have to do with any foreigner?
Yes, I wanted to say something in regards to the 70 trillion shadow banking you mentioned earlier. I'm aware that through Basel III, one of the regulations was in regard to the disclosures that banks have to have, you know, in terms of their of the bonuses and the general their remuneration package to high earners, as we put them. And that was, in a way, to curb the huge bonuses that were once given. And one of the rules there is that the variable part should not exceed 100% of the fixed. And I was wondering your opinion about that and whether that's a good way forward to try and limit that shadow banking that's been going on. And also in terms of the banks that are not or were previously not regulated, and I believe there's an effort there after the toxic case with starting in the States, where they started to regulate more.
Yes, I don't think that bankers' remuneration and bankers' bonuses were the only cause. The incentives within the global financial system are wrong. And don't forget, these guys are answerable to shareholders who will always push the boat to borrow more and more and more because debt is cheap, because leverage will expand the balance sheet, and the balance sheet will expand profit, and the profit will end up with the shareholders. So even if you control banker behavior, still these guys, first of all, I'm not sure that you can control it just by remuneration. These guys want to be promoted, and they want to be kept in their jobs. If the shareholders, who are the owners, only favor senior management that piles up the debt in order to expand the balance sheet and expand profit, even if you are a saint, you will not survive in that environment. You will be fired. Whatever is the regulation of remuneration is not enough. You need to go to the heart of the problem. And the heart of the problem is it pays off to be a speculator rather than a long-term investor. That has to be redressed. The market has failed to redress it itself, so we have a market failure. We cannot redress it through regulation, like the regulation that you mentioned, because it can have adverse effects, moral hazard, or become too complex. We need to find a simple, comprehensive, practical, and implementable idea to address what's going on in the markets. And as a matter of fact, banks are not that important any longer. The main problem is with the markets, where the banks are a bit of a part player. The important thing is what happens with that loose money that's around 70 trillion, if not more. How you turn them from gambling to providing welfare gains. So just focusing on one target group, which you can use for scapegoating, justifiably so, is not enough. The incentives in the system are rotten to their bone.
Western governments, democratically elected governments, provide counterbalance to the markets at the moment, which are not capable of fully regulating themselves. What's likely to happen in the next 10 or 20 years when the biggest economy in the world is likely to be China, and that doesn't have a democratically elected government to regulate the markets?
Well, the relationship between the markets and the governments at the level of global finance is very weak. The only reason that China has maintained a grip, unlike other governments, is because China is controlling the circulation of its currency. The United States lost any control over dollar markets when lots of dollars start being exported in order to pay oil-producing countries, and those dollars were never repatriated, stayed there in the international space, and started being transacted there as a valid currency, even though they had no country of origin. Okay, so as soon as the yuan becomes the new dollar, the Chinese government, however democratic or undemocratic it is, will lose control over its economy. And I don't think they understand that.
Thank you for your very interesting talk. Under your sketch of taxing the so-called bad financial instruments versus reducing taxes on the good ones, I just wonder if you could expand how you would see determining ex post which was good and which was bad, because that seems to be unclear to me.
Well, it's the perfect way to determine ex post how much damage or good the financial product has done, because I will measure the returns on it, both for the investor and the holder and the traders and society. And if what I see is a socially useful credit default swap, which as a matter of fact is an insurance contract, but we call it a financial product, traded again and again and again and again, generating a turnover of a trillion with no social value, I think this is it's time to really tax that seriously. But the best way to judge that is ex post, when I have the financial data in front of me. And if I see something else that I see as dangerous, which has proved to be not as dangerous, I lower the tax on that.